So now we have learned about linear transformations. We've learned about linear combinations. And now we're going to put those together and use that knowledge to come up with a new concept called a matrix. And what you're going to notice is that a matrix is a convenient way of representing a linear transformation. It all starts with this theorem. What does the theorem say? Theorem says if we're given k vectors and k scalars, then if we take a linear combination of those vectors using those scalars, and then we apply a linear transformation to that, you get the same result as if you first applied the linear transformation and then took the linear combination of the result of that. Now, we've already seen this when we start with two vectors and two scalars. Okay, so if we take a linear combination of two vectors using two scalars and then we transform, we get the same result as if we first transform those vectors and then take the linear combination. This particular theorem is a natural extension. Now, you might say this is obvious, but by now you've learned that if you say this is obvious, then we really want you to prove it. So as a homework exercise, we're going to ask you to prove this. And you may either take a break right now and prove that, or we can go on and you can prove the result later on. So a more concise notation for this is take a linear combination of the vectors, then transform, or transform first, and then take the linear combination of the results. Very important is to remember that any time you're given some vector in Rn, you can write it as a linear combination of the unit basis vectors. We saw that in week one. Okay. And remember that we used the notation E0 for the first unit basis vector, E1 for the second one, and so forth. More concisely, we can write this as such. So what's really going on here? The vector x can be written as the linear combination of the unit basis vectors that uses the coefficients that are the components of the vector x. Very, very important for the next steps that we're going to look at. So, let's say that L is a linear transformation, and let's say that we're now given some vector x. Let's call y the result of applying L to the vector x. What do we know? Well, we know that x can be written as the linear combination of the unit basis vectors. But we have also learned that you can either take the linear combination of the vectors first and then transform, or you can transform each of those vectors first and then take the linear combination. Each of the unit basis vectors inherently results in some vector. Let's call that vector a sub j. So all we have here is we say, look, we have a linear transformation. We're going to say that the vector that you get when you transform the jth unit basis vector is called aj. It's some vector. What you then notice is that L of x, this result vector y, is simply a linear combination of those vectors. Okay, so if you know what those vectors are, then you know how to evaluate L of x, even if you don't know what that function is, because you can simply take the linear combination of those vectors. Alternatively, maybe I should say alternatively, you can say, well, L of x is equal to L of this linear combination of the unit basis vectors, and that's just the linear combinations of the vectors that you get when you transform the unit basis vectors. I cannot stress how important this is. The linear transformation L is completely described by that set of vectors. You don't need to know what the linear transformation is. You merely need to know how the unit basis vectors have been transformed by that linear transformation. And again, here we summarize why. Okay, I find this so important that I keep saying it. L is completely described by how it transforms the unit basis vectors. We're going to give you lots of homework on this because this is so important. What is a matrix? If you take these vectors that are the transformed unit basis vectors and you simply organize them in a two-dimensional array, so that the first column here is that first vector A0 and the second column here is that second vector A1, etc., then notice that that array of numbers completely describes L. This here is called the matrix that describes the linear transformation L. Okay, so a matrix is merely a convenient way of storing information about a linear transformation. Once we have that matrix that represents the linear transformation, we can use the notation A times X to mean L evaluated at X. So matrix vector multiplication, which you've probably seen in another math class or in a physics class or somewhere else, is merely defined the way it's defined because matrix vector multiplication has exactly the same net result as applying the linear transformation to the vector X. Now, what does that mean about how you have to evaluate A times X? Well, A times X is the same as L of X. It is the same as the linear combination of those columns of the matrix A. If we expose the individual entries of those columns, we get this right here. So now we're doing a scalar times a vector plus a scalar times a vector, etc. That's a linear combination. But we know how to scale vectors and how to add them, so then you end up with this result right here. And now we're almost there, because what we recognize is that scalar multiplication commutes, and therefore we can say alpha 0, 0 times chi 0 plus alpha 0, 1 times chi 1, etc. computes the first component of the result vector, etc., etc., etc. And if you think about it, this is the formula for matrix vector multiplication that you've probably already seen. So remember from high school, A times X is defined as this times that plus this times that plus blah, 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 plus this times that for the first component. Then this times that plus this times that plus blah, 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 plus this times that for the second component. And then for the final component, it's this times that plus this times that, etc., plus this times that. Okay, and that's summarized right here. Okay, so these are just individual components of the result vector. This is probably the definition of matrix vector multiplication that you've seen before somewhere. So to summarize, the action of a linear transformation is completely described by how it transforms the unit basis vectors. We can represent a linear transformation by a two-dimensional array that we call a matrix. And evaluating the linear transformation is equivalent to performing the matrix vector multiplication as you know it.